Welcome to the Defense and Aerospace Report. I'm Vagha Murati, and here at the Surface Navy Association's annual conference and trade show just outside Washington, D.C., the number one gathering of the U.S. Navy's surface warfare leaders and indeed leaders from across the force. We're partnered with SNA on covering this event, and our sponsors are Huntington Ingalls Industries, General Electric Marine, L3 Technologies, and Leonardo DRS. And we're talking to Captain Christopher Barnes, who is the Deputy Commander of the Surface and Mine Warfighting Development Center in sunny San Diego, where you've kept, where you've lived for and served for most of your career. A lot of talk about the capabilities you're bringing to bear. You know, Admiral Brown, the head of Surface Forces, talked about it. Admiral Boxall did as well. You've been there since the formation of an institution that's really designed to improve the warfighting skills of the force. Talk to us a little bit about the progression, the progress you guys have made in 3 years before we even get to all the new stuff that you guys are going to be doing, given that Admiral Brown talked a little bit about bringing back the development squadrons, the DEVRON construct, which aviators have had for a long time and submariners have had for a long time. Walk us through what you guys have accomplished in the last 3 years.
Well, I think the biggest thing we've accomplished is creating this WTI, or Warfare Tactics Instructor Program. It started out with the IMD Witties at a Dog in Virginia, and it followed up with the ASW-SW Witties out of San Diego. We expanded to the AMW Witty Program out of Little Creek, Virginia, and we're actually about to kick off the Mine Warfare WTI Program, out of Point Loma here in San Diego. So that's probably the biggest and most important thing we've done, because those witties are what we use. They're our tool to increasing the tactical efficiency and the warfighting capability of our platforms today.
Just to let our audience know, right? I mean, it's not just what you guys are doing there, but again, each one of these individual centers that you're creating to work together to get that expertise and the warfighting skills sharpened up in this great power competition that we're in now. The key to this is rapid learning, right? The Chief of Naval Operations, John Richardson, has talked about this. His new Sea Power design for Sea Power 2.0 is out now as well with a couple of new mouthful acronyms that are part of that. But from your perspective, as the trainer of the trainers that are going out into the force, what are the keys to rapid learning and rapid innovation? Because that's, you know, that experimental warfighting and the new concepts part, you're working with the Naval War College on that as well as the warfare communities. Walk us through a little bit about what are the keys to learning and learning rapidly and distributing that learning across the force?
Yeah, so Under the old paradigm of PBED, plan, brief, execute, debrief, now under 2.0, it's a P5, which is plan, practice, perform, progress, and promulgate. But a lot of that's a mouthful.
Well done, sir.
Yeah. Well done.
But the key there is, as surface warfare officers, we've always kind of done this PBED piece, but what we didn't do well was take that debrief and close the loop back to the planning piece. So we use that process for rapid learning by, we will do an event during SWAT, which is the Surface Warfare Advanced Tactical Training, and we'll do it at a basic level. And then we'll immediately, within 24 hours, but usually within 12 hours, we will do we'll take the data reconstruction, collect it with the NSWC Corona or NUIC up in Washington State, and we take all that information, our witties dissect it, and then they look for learning opportunities out of a particular scenario we may have run. And we take that watch team and the other watch teams that are involved with, say if it's an air defense event, and we get them together and we do a really thorough debrief. That includes the ground truth data, or what really was happening. But the even better part is it includes voice. So people can hear what they said, because a lot of times when you're in the heat of the moment, you don't remember what you said. But when they get to hear what they said and then understand what those mistakes were, we find that they correct it on the spot, and the next time they do it, they're doing it correctly. So we see a really rapid increase, even over a 10 to 16 day SWAT event, where the watchstanders are getting extremely proficient, not only at the understanding and exercising those tactics, but in that warfighting role that they're that they carry in combat. So it's exciting.
Well, but, you know, there are times when people think they're saying the right thing and they're sometimes not saying the right thing, right? So even going to that granular level of detail of being like, hey, here's where things could have possibly gone wrong because folks did not have as clear of an idea of what you as the leader were trying to say and what you were trying to do.
Correct. And another piece of that is that's the rapid replay portion, which is obviously what the CNO was focused on. But the other piece of that is we take all that data we collect over a 16 period and we send it back to Corona. And about a month later, because they've done a massive deep dive, more in the technical side of things, but we're able to figure out, hey, did the guy mash the right button at the right time? And if he did mash the right button at the right time, did the system perform and operate the way he or she thought it was? And if it did, then all's good. But if it didn't, we're able to make not only tactical recommendations to our TTP and make those changes, but we're also able to make technical recommendations to the IWSs and the NS and the NAVCs to improve our combat systems on board our ships. That's really groundbreaking stuff.
How are you, and I understand that the DEVRON structure, which is great that it's back and folks have been calling for it for quite some time actually, and I know this is still early days, but how is this all going to work and what's your role going to be in this new ecosystem that obviously will also have some sort of dotted line to the Naval War College, right? Which is also working on advanced warfighting and development concepts. So talk to us about how all of this is going to work as the Navy, you know, is really gearing up. You know, I thought it was great the way Admiral Brown started his talk, which is at the height of the Cold War, we were trading paint, we were doing, you know, guys were shadowing us, you know, Soviets were getting into our battle group formations and we literally had to chase them out. How does this new intellectual ecosystem going to be working?
Well, I'm actually excited about it because I see an opportunity here that we haven't been able to do for a long time. So it's really going to be the DEVRON working directly for SERFPAC, and we would be in a supporting role for them. And how do I say a supporting role? Well, we're going to help with the witties. We're going to put some talented folks on, assign them to particular experimentation efforts that they're working.
And what is the WITI, just so you can explain for our audience? Because you've used that acronym a few times, but I'm not sure everybody knows what it is.
Okay, it's a warfare tactics instructor. And as I stated earlier, we have air defense WITIs, we have surface, subsurface WITIs, we have amphibious warfare WITIs, and of course we have the mine warfare WITIs coming this summer. So these are experts, these are tactically proficient because they study and they work on specific areas. They get subject matter experts, expert areas assigned to them when they're going through the program. So we will assign those folks as at the request of the DEVRON, and they will work with the DEVRON on the experimentation piece so that they can develop that TTP. Because one of our goals from that perspective is no new technology or no new system arrives to the fleet without a corresponding at least draft TTP. That way they have something to exercise with the test before it really becomes operational. So that's one of the big pieces. And of course the other piece is because we do a variety of different underway events, of which SWAT is our big one, we can provide them a platform to do some of this testing and experimentation they want to do. So we're really excited about it. And we're excited about the chance to work with them.
Let's talk a little bit about integrated air and missile defenses, something obviously that, you know, at the height of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, there weren't a lot of people who were paying a lot of attention to it. Now, when we look at the contested environments in which naval forces will have to operate, you know, nobody ever defended their way to victory, but the defense part is an important piece of projecting that power from naval forces. Talk to us about the renaissance that's going on now in the field and how you guys are actually in the vanguard of that.
Well, so first of all, I people say we became very defensive over a period of time because we didn't need to be offensive because, as Admiral Brown mentioned, we woke up one day and we owned the seas. We had total sea control. But over time, we've, you know, some competitors have come into play, and it's actually forced us to not only continue to work from a defensive posture, but also look at it from an offensive posture. In order to ensure that we do maintain sea control so that there's freedom of navigation throughout the world. So we will continue to look at things both offensively and defensively, and we will look to improve tactics with the systems that are online today so that we can be a more proficient warfighting team from an offensive perspective. But as I stated earlier, we're going to look for the, we're really looking hard for those upcoming and emerging technologies that will make us a better warfighting force from an offense perspective. And that really is weapons that reach farther than weapons we have today, which is something we're always working on.
And obviously the SIAT trainers, which are the, combined integrated air missile defense?
Combined integrated air and ASW trainer.
You know, all of those capabilities, I mean, it's really fascinating time to see how that synthetic environment training is really, really advancing, and eventually get it on each one of the individual ships so that you can actually exercise this in the in different scenarios in much more novel and constructive ways.
Yeah, so the SIAT trainers are owned by CSCS, but we work hand in hand with them on A, validating the systems that exist today, but more importantly, we're looking for opportunities from a SMITIC perspective, how we would use them in the future. And I see a couple different ways. We have always wanted, when the time is right, when the technology is available, to do synthetic training during our in-port academics prior to a SWAT event. And the benefit of that is we can get the watch teams in there to get reps and sets, both from an air defense perspective as well as an ASW perspective. So we're really excited about that. And then the other piece is, I want our WIDIs, so in the case of the, you know, today with the SIAT trainer, I want all my IMD WIDIs to be extremely tactically proficient at standing the air watch station. So we're looking at ways to put, they have 10 consoles in the SIAT trainer. I'm looking to put one guy standing, we call it Whiskeys, the lead air defense watch station. All the other ones would be ship watch stations, and just running reps and sets so that they're extremely proficient. So when we go out to train the fleet, we're even providing more and better training than we are today.
And a quick lesson for all of our viewers who always stumble over your acronym, because there are a whole bunch of people who totally mispronounce it all the time, like, what is your acronym? How, sir, should people refer to your command?
SMITIC. So now, in defense of many people, when 3.5-4 years ago, when we were starting to stand up, we went through about 3 iterations of what the name right. really is. So, but we settled on, Surface and Mine Warfighting Development Center, which is SMITIC.
Captain Chris Barnes, the SMITIC Deputy Commander, sir, absolute pleasure. Thanks very much. Best of luck on the initiative, and hope you have a successful Surface Navy Conference.
Thank you.